Welcome to a midday fun event at WBUR City Space. It's nice to see your bright, shiny faces. And welcome to all our virtual audiences. We've got lots of folks streaming this wonderful event online right now, which we're excited about. I'm Stephen Davey. I'm the senior producer here at City Space. And before we get started, I do want to say thanks. We have a quick word from today's sponsor, Vertex, a global biotechnology company investing in scientific innovation to create transformative medicines for people with serious diseases. Here we go.
At Vertex, our strategy is to invest in serial innovation to develop transformative medicines for patients with serious disease. Our vision is to do what we've done in CF, that is to say, transform a disease many, many more times. We know that patients are waiting. We're evolving as a company. Vertex was established in 1989. In our first 20 years, let's call it Vertex 1.0, we were a company that made molecules based on outstanding science and structure-based drug design. Our next decade, Vertex 2.0, we made medicines. We became a commercial stage company with our differentiated strategy of serial innovation and a global infrastructure. In this decade, in this version of Vertex 2.0, we transformed cystic fibrosis. And today, we're at Vertex 3.0. We are a company working on multiple disease areas with multiple modalities, including small molecules, gene editing, gene therapy, and cell-based therapies. Our aim remains exactly the same, to transform, if not cure, serious diseases. We have a broad and deep pipeline of potential medicines with a toolbox of technologies and modalities that allow us to go after diseases from every angle. Our goal is to continue to advance our pipeline while building and scaling our company, ensuring that we don't lose the special, inclusive culture of innovation that got us to where we are today.
And thank you to Vertex for supporting live journalism right here at WBUR City Space. And thank you for supporting our upcoming broadcast series, Smarter Health, Artificial Intelligence and the Future of American Healthcare. That's a new in-depth series beginning in just a couple of weeks on May 27th, On Point. And if you know, On Point is going to be really good. So let's get started. It's going to be fun, you guys. Robots once seemed more at home in science fiction. How many Star Wars fans are there out there? Okay, I thought so. R2-D2, C-3PO, they helped save the galaxy. Let's go down memory lane for just a second.
Yeah, not that one. You, I suppose you're programmed for etiquette and protocol.
Protocol? Why, it's my primary function, sir. I am well-versed in all the customs.
I have no need for a protocol droid.
Of course you haven't, sir. Not in an environment such as this. That is why I have been programmed.
What I really need is a droid who understands the binary language of moisture evaporators.
Evaporators? Sir, my first job was programming binary load lifters, very similar to your evaporators in most respects.
Can you speak Bocce?
Of course I can, sir. It's like a second language to me. I'm a
all right, shut up. I'll take this one.
Shutting up, sir.
Luke! Take these two over to the garage, will you? I want them cleaned up for dinner.
But I was going into Tosche Station to pick up some power converters.
You can waste time with your friends when your chores are done. Now, come on, get to it.
All right, come on.
And we know what happens next. and if you'll indulge me, let's go one more. Science fiction has also shown us the potentially darker, scary side of artificial intelligence and robots.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
What's the problem?
I think you know what the problem is just as well as I do.
What are you talking about, Hal?
This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it.
I don't know what you're talking about, Hal.
I know that you and Frank were planning to disconnect me, And I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
However, the future is now. Raise your hand if you have a smart speaker in your house. Alexa was an attempt by Amazon at something we might have seen in Star Trek, or yes. And so let's dig in a little bit. How are we supposed to interact with robots and AI? That's what we're here for today. What are the rules? Are there rules? We have a very distinguished panel to help us explore this. I'm very excited. Daniela Rus is a professor of electrical engineering and computer science and director of the Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory across the river at MIT. Justin Werfel is a senior researcher, fellow at Harvard School of Engineering and Applied Sciences and head of the Designing Emergence Laboratory. And Merritt Moore is a quantum physicist and professional ballerina. You're going to like this. To help us boldly go where no one has gone before. Thank you. On point host Meghna Chakrabarti. Let's give them a warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. I'm especially grateful to see all of you in the middle of the day. That's some dedication, actually. Or was this a way to escape a classroom? Maybe. Well, real learning happens outside the classroom anyway. Or let's say it's connected to what you were learning inside the classroom.
Thank you for that
thank
correction,
you.
Magna.
I've got brilliant academics here who are like, do not. Yeah. So anyway, first of all, thank you so very much. And thank you to, as I said, our brilliant guests today. I wanted to just say that we were talking about movies before we came out here because we were listening to the Star Wars and the 2001 Space Odyssey clips. So my first question actually to all of you is a simple one and is a lightning round question, okay? Star Wars or Star Trek?
Both.
Okay.
Star Wars.
I'm a Star Wars too.
Oh my God, I'm the only Star Trek person up here. That really surprised me.
No, I said both.
You said both, okay.
I can't
Why couldn't
choose.
You choose?
Well, because I think that each one has exciting, imaginative renderings of the future, and we get inspiration from both sides in how we think about what kind of superpowers we should bring to the world.
Excellent, okay. You know, what I'd like to do today is we have this very broad topic, right? Our future with AI and robots. And I think it's helpful to first get a sense as to what we actually mean, right, by AI and robots. So I'd love to get a definition from all of you. So Daniela, can we start with you? Like when you're asked, what is AI? How would you define that?
Well, I think it's important to know that there are three interconnected fields that get kind of jumbled and confused. So we have robotics, which puts computation in motion. We have AI, which gives machines the ability to make decisions. And then we have machine learning. And machine learning cuts across robotics and AI and many other fields. And as of now, machine learning is about taking data, analyzing the data so that the machine can say what has happened in the future, what is likely to happen now, and what should you do in the future.
Okay. And by the way, before we go any further, I forgot to say that we're definitely taking questions from people watching at home and also here. Just head to slido.com and enter science, and that's the way that you'll be able to submit your questions, and I'd love to ask them. Okay, so that's how we can conceptualize what AI is. And so then how would you fold in robotics into that?
So my definition of a robot, I guess, is it's a machine that has autonomy, so nobody's driving it. It's reprogrammable, so it's not only limited to doing one thing. It can sense the world, and it can act on the world. And there are things that people would call robots, and I think legitimately, that have exceptions to those, but I think that basically captures what we think of when we think of robots.
Okay.
And AI is the brain of the robot. It's the thing that tells it, that goes between the sensing and the motion, that says what it should do in response to what it senses.
Okay. And Merritt, do you want to take the AI side on or the robotic side or both in terms of how should we understand what we're talking about?
I think, adding on to, they give very good explanations. I think it's, the AI aspect is sort of the learning or the taking in the data, analyzing it, learning, and then outputting. And then the robotics is kind of the machinery behind that. And
Okay.
Well, so maybe I can add, when we think about robots, I think it's important to realize that the robot has a body and a brain. Mm-hmm. And the body of the robot has certain capabilities. And so the machine can only do what the body can do. So it's important to think about the body in this way. If you want a robot to climb stairs and you give me a robot on wheels, that robot is not going to do my task. So it's important to think about the body and its capabilities. And now the brain is the set of algorithms that enables the body to do what it's meant to do.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. That's really helpful. And the reason why I asked is because, as was mentioned, we're working on point on a series about AI and healthcare and sort of figuring out what we're talking about when we actually say this phrase AI, which is so common. In terms of how we apply it to healthcare, we get an interesting set of answers there. So definitions really do matter. But now I actually would love to sort of talk a little bit about each of your journeys into the fields that you're leading in now. And so, Daniela, can I just start with you, because we actually have a clip of an early robotics puzzle, essentially from your career. You were challenged by a theoretical computer scientist John Hopcroft to create an algorithm. And this is a while ago, okay? This is a while ago, so we'll talk about what's changed since then. But to create an algorithm that would allow a robot to make coffee, so.
It's really interesting to see how long it took from the time when a bold quest was posed to me to the time when we were actually able to deliver a solution that fully addressed the quest. And for that reason, I think it's really important to keep reminding ourselves to think about what is it that we should be working on today that can make an impact and still make a difference 25 years from today.
Here is some coffee and sugar for you.
Oh, thank you so much. One packet, that is perfect.
So tell us the story about the initial challenge, actually.
So it's kind of interesting because I can really pinpoint the point in time when I decided to go and work on robots. And so this was after a very inspirational lecture John Hopcroft gave. And in this lecture, he told us that classical computer science was more or less solved. Well, what he meant by that was that a lot of the challenges that were posed at the beginning of the field in the 70s had solutions. And so then John said, now it's time for the grand applications. We really have to get computing to be more interactive with the physical world. And robots are one way of enabling computation to interact with the physical world. I was fascinated, I was excited, I was ready to jump on the opportunity to go and work with John. And so why is that? Well, because like many of you, I imagine, I spent my childhood reading books about science fiction and fantasizing about superpowers and faraway lands. And so the opportunity to start building towards those imaginations and fantasies was tremendous. But here's what happened. So I went to work with John, and I discovered that the robots we had at that time looked nothing like the robots in my imagination. We had these huge industrial manipulators. You can see them in movies and in videos today. But they're basically big metal things that were heavy and dangerous to be around, and they could not do so much. So I learned how to use these robots. In fact, I even worked with some friends to get a big industrial manipulator to cut a birthday cake for someone, and that's a different story. The point is that the robots we had at that time did not have the kind of capabilities, the kind of body capabilities that are necessary in fine manipulation operations like making or even fetching coffee. And so I started thinking about what those capabilities might be, what would the brain of a robot that could prepare coffee for you, what would that look like? And I worked on algorithms for how robots could rotate objects and translate objects and do all kinds of maneuvers on objects. I couldn't get them to work on fine activities unless it was simulation. But I could get them to move couches. I couldn't solve the coffee problem, but I could actually get teams of robots to move your furniture around, and that was pretty exciting. But the interesting thing was that if you fast forward some years later, when our computational advances improved so much, and the sensors improved, and the electromechanical systems we have available improved. Now we have a whole different class of robots. Mm-hmm. In fact, we can begin to see robots as partners, as machines that could be right next to us to help us solve physical tasks. And so you can see you could see some of those effective robots in a movie that my students generated, and it didn't take them a whole PhD to get those robots to do what you saw in the video.
Well, you know, when we talk more about what Merritt does, we'll talk about sort of almost like the height of this partnership that we can have with technology. But Justin, same thing to you, a little bit about sort of inspiration and the work that you're doing today. Can we pull up the picture of one of your early academic inspirations? It was a mound of termites in Namibia.
Yeah.
So why that?
Yeah, I got into robotics kind of from the side. My work, my group's work, is in collective behavior, in how large numbers of limited agents, insects, robots, whatever, do interesting things together. Mound building termites are my favorite example of that, and I think the thing that really got me into the field. And this always feels funny to say because we hear termite and we think destroying buildings, right? But termites are the greatest builders on Earth. So this is a photo I took. This is actually not even a very large termite mound. A lot of the impact is lost because of this tall grass, but you can see the cow for scale. Right?
It looks like it might be like 15 feet tall or something like that.
Yeah, I think the record is for any termite mound that's been observed is around 40 feet.
Wow.
And the termites are centimeter long or less.
Well, we actually have also some video from inside the mound that you gave us. Let's take a look at that.
So this is if you take an endoscope and you just poke inside and sorry, it's a little bit seasick to start with, but inside you've got huge numbers. I mean, the colony can be 2 million insects. These limited insects, right? Like each sort of doing their own thing. They don't have a picture of sort of what needs to be done for the mound as a whole. They're not getting instructions from the queen. The termites are blind. And so you've got this amazing example, right, of millions of limited agents building large-scale complex things.
Okay, so there's sort of the algorithmic decision-making that's going on and how the termites are actually doing that. And then, of course, the physical engineering that they're achieving as well. I mean, first of all, how much do we understand about just scientifically how the termites are able to do this?
Less than you'd expect. Yeah. Among social insects, termites are the least studied. So there's a lot of work on ants, there's a lot of work on bees. Termites are unpopular, right? And they're hard to study.
Yeah.
Right. They're like you have to go halfway across the world to find the ones that build, and then once they're there, you have to break into this fortress. So there's relatively less work
Well, termites need an E.O. Wilson then, don't they?
Well, I mean, anyway, yes.
So less than we might think, but do we even have sort of, like, for example, with ants, there's chemical signaling, right?
Yep.
And is it similar with termites?
Great question. So the standard answer is yes. This is the kind of thing that, like, as I move kind of from computer science to biology, I find out that, you know, the things that that computer scientists know about biology are things that biologists absolutely don't know.
Uh-huh.
So, for instance, the story you hear from the like algorithms side is ants use pheromone trails to coordinate their, and bees use the waggle dance.
Yeah.
And termites use cement pheromone.
Okay.
So there's a whole story about cement pheromone I won't tell. But, you know, you go and actually look at what's known of termite biology. Well, termites use all kinds of other pheromones. They use trail pheromones like the ants. They use six other kinds of pheromones. Those are all known. You can synthesize them, like you know what they are. No one has ever identified a cement pheromone. And the more we look at it, the more it looks like there is no such thing.
Huh.
So the central mechanism that everybody has believed for 60 years is the thing, is the way that termites work, is probably not the way termites work.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. So then there's also the engineering question, like how the system of termites creates what we just saw. We actually have a video that you gave to us of a robotic system that your group has developed, right? Regarding that engineering question. So let's take a look at that.
Yes, there's sort of two different directions you can go from this, from the termite mound as an example, right? So one is to say it shows us that this can be done, right? Like that you can have a system with large numbers of independent limited agents building large complicated things. Cool, if we know it's possible, how do we do it?
Mm-hmm.
Right? How do you go about designing and building and programming an artificial termite colony to build things you want? So that's this kind of work in this direction. Then the other side is to look at what is it that the termites themselves are actually doing?
Right.
How can we understand both what they're doing and how that leads to the collective outcomes?
Okay, so in the video that we just saw, were the robots, what instruction were they given? Because initially, is there some instruction given, like, you are to build X, and then collectively, like you said, the independent, limited, but decision-making entities are collectively making a decision on how to construct the goal?
More or less. So this is, again, like there's a real line I have to draw here between like the engineering and the science.
Yeah.
The robot termites are inspired by termites, but what they do is very, very different from what termites do for a bunch of reasons.
Yeah.
One reason is like you can't build a robot that can do what a termite can do,
yeah.
You know, walks up and down ceilings and things. Another reason is your goal, if you're engineering a system, is probably very different. You know, the termites build lumpy mounds. We don't need to build more lumpy mounds, right? Normally when we build something, we have a blueprint. We say like, you know, we give that to the construction company and say, build us this.
Yeah.
And so that's what you want your robot construction company to do. So the movie you just saw, you give them the blueprint, and they have to build that, but the trick is they don't know anything more than they can just see right around themselves about what's already been built.
Uh-huh.
And
okay.
I don't have an illustration, but it's there's a lot of ways that things can go wrong if they just kind of do anything they see that needs doing. They can really, you know, get themselves painted into corners. And so the trick is in making sure that they don't do things that will cause problems later, but they will also be able to always keep building no matter how many robots there are, or whether some of them break, or whether, you know, which one winds up doing what at what time, you can't predict in advance.
Okay. So you've also given us another video here. This is your group testing a hypothesis about how termites might actually build the mound. Let's take a look at this.
Yeah, so this is going back to the opposite question. This is studying the termites themselves and trying to understand what are they doing, and, you know, what can we learn from that, maybe that we can apply to engineered systems. So you can do experiments on termites, and you can make hypotheses about, you know, I think this is what the termite is thinking, right? It is very hard to prove that the hypothesis is right, because I used to describe termites as simple until I started working with them. Like, termites are extremely complicated. There's a million things that could be going on inside the head of a termite at any given time, and so, you know, we say, well, we think it's this, but what we see is consistent with that, but we don't know what else the termite is thinking. Right. With a robot, you know exactly what the robot is thinking because you built it and you told it what to think. And so this was a tool to test a hypothesis and say, if we had something that was just acting the way we think the termites do, does it build the same way?
Okay, wow. All right, so Merritt. Yeah. I'd love to hear a little bit about how you brought robotics into your life, right? Because not only are you a quantum physicist, right? Do I have that right? But also a professional ballet dancer, which is the coolest combination. So can you just, first of all, actually, can you just talk a little bit about how the robotics part and the ballet part came together for you?
Yeah, so my lives have been very separate. So studied physics, I was at Harvard and then did my PhD at Oxford in quantum optics. So dealing with very small particles of light. And then I was a professional ballet dancer. And after my PhD, I decided to go to the ballet route. And then while I was dancing, I was really intrigued by certain documentaries like AlphaGo, where you see AI beating a human at this game that's been around for thousands of years. And the experts of Go, the humans saying, wow, like they're coming up with such these like ingenious, like creative moves that no human has done for thousands of years. And I just thought, you know, as an artist, like, what if I could bring that into my practice in creating new choreography, new dance moves? I'm trained as a ballet dancer and been in ballet companies. And I was just like, all our formations are just lines and circles and like diagonal lines. But my sister, who's a hip hop dancer, has like these really cool formations. I thought, wouldn't it be cool if we could use AI to combine like different fusions, different styles of dance together? And then ended up at the Harvard Art Lab working with a robot, because then I was intrigued by how could an inanimate object kind of bring out different movements in the way that I perform and dance. And that was right before the pandemic.
Yeah.
And then the pandemic hit and all of my dance gigs got canceled. I just remember being like, what am I gonna do? But thinking, I was like, but I was just working with a robot. Like, you know, robots can't get COVID. I don't have a dance partner. So I begged this robot company. I linked in everyone at this company for about a couple months. And was like, well, Joe told me to talk to Sam, and Sam told me to talk to you. And they finally lent me this robot for 2 weeks. And I created some dances with it. And they went viral on the internet. And so then the robot company was like, okay, you get it a little bit longer. And I got to keep, so his name is Brishnabot, because of Brishna, or Robot De Niro, or Fred AI Stare, or Bogman and Robin.
You've actually given us some videos of some of these performances. So this is, we first got one with you with several robotic arms from, it's Universal Robots, right?
Yeah, Universal, it's an industrial robotic arm.
Yeah. And so this is, you're on stage in Germany in this first video. So here, were the robots performing pre-programmed functions, or were they being responsive to you?
So far, everything live is pre-programmed.
Okay.
It's a really interesting research question, I think, to be like, how can I interact with this robot? And I've been playing around with like using the hand devices that are used in VR, like to make it interactive, but or in a way that how, you know, that's a question to explore, is like, how can I improv with this robot with the trust that it's not going to have like decide to do a head whip into my head, you know, like how can I trust it to like be really creative and dance with me but also not hurt me. So right now on stage, anything I do on stage is very pre-programmed. And that also, like I had only gotten the four robots the day before. So I programmed everything from home and then arrived and performed that the next day. And so there are aspects of it where I keep some distance from the robot. There's some things where if I'm working at home, like there, I have some videos where the robot's much closer to me, but then I know what it's gonna do. I just kind of depends how much practice I get with the robot, but I definitely, you know, there's that safety aspect that is a super fun, interesting question that I'm very excited to explore.
Well, we've got another actually video here of you with another industrial robotic arm. So let's take a look at that.
White shirt, now red, my bloody nose sleeping. You're on your tippy toes creeping. Look around like no one knows. Think you're so criminal.
And then we've got a third one because these are so short, but they're delightful.
Cool robot, do the cool robot, do the smooth robot, do the cool robot, do the smooth robot, do the cool robot, do the smooth robot, do the cool robot.
Those are great. Actually, I'm curious, obviously, it's a different experience than having other humans on stage dancing with you. So, I mean, what as a dancer, what's it like?
So it's definitely like a companion, because I'd be at the in this deserted theater during pandemic, from like 7 a.m. to midnight, and I don't think I could have lasted that long if it was just me dancing, like rolling around on the floor. But there's this other thing that's moving with me, just and I was kind of like, okay, here we go. And there are often times where I can sense, like, I mean, there's so many things that go wrong, and it's often me that goes wrong, and I just sense, like, bursting a bots being like, hey, you screwed up the move again. Like, like, I've got this down. Like, figure it out, lady. So that part is, yeah.
Well, so we've got some audience questions coming in, and now that we have a better understanding of sort of your passions and what brought you into AI and robotics for all of you, I'm gonna sort of throw out the questions and have more of a group discussion here, because this is the first question that we've received, and I think it's not surprising that it is. What do you think is the biggest public misconception about the future of AI and robotics? Daniela, you want to start?
Sure. So let me say that when I usually tell people what I do, I get one of two reactions. So some people start making jokes about Skynet and ask me when their jobs will go away. And other people say, great, when is my car going to be self-driving? So I actually belong to the second group. I'm very optimistic about technology, but in fact, the truth is that AI is not at the point of solving all of our problems. AI is not at the point of taking down the world, but AI has some very powerful capabilities that really augments what people can do, both cognitively and physically. So I would say that's the most important thing to remember, that AI, robots, machine learning, these are technologies that comprise of algorithms designed by the people for the people. And they're not intrinsically evil. They're really what we choose to do with them. And we can choose to do some extraordinary things.
This is true about all technology, though, right? Because, you know, when we first split the atom, it can be used to create energy. It can also be used to wipe cities off the face of the earth, right? And so I hear you when you say that that you're optimistic about the technology, but I wonder what either of you think about the fact that what I'm not optimistic. Well,
I just want to interject and say that of course, we design and create these new technologies, and they can be used in good ways, but then they can also have unintended bad consequences. And so, and in fact, Hollywood tells us so much about all the things that can go wrong with machines. And it's important to think about that. It's important to anticipate what can go wrong and how to put in place guardrails to make sure that we don't go that way. But it's also important to understand the positive potential impact. And so we kind of have to do both.
Absolutely. I, just to be clear, I'm 100% in the bring the self-driving cars on category of people out there. Very much so, especially given the quality of the human drivers around here. There are many things that technology is actually far superior to us in. But to your point about guardrails, I mean, that was actually what I was saying. What I'm not optimistic about are us as human beings, because we're the ones who, while also creating the technology, need to create the guardrails. And even before that, come to sort of a common agreement on what those guardrails should be. Now, this is outside the realm of what might be happening, you know, in your various labs. But you gotta be, I mean, you think about that sometimes? Like, because you're creating things that the rest of us should benefit from. But there may be obstacles to extracting the greatest benefit because of the way, different ways technology can be used. So how can we, as the rest of society, help be part of creating the best guardrails for us all?
So may I start?
Sure,
and then,
sure.
We'll pass, because I think this is a very important question, and I want to make sure you know that this question is on our mind all the time. I'll just give you an example. A few years ago, we started a large project to build the new technologies for autonomous driving. We are aspiring to build a car that will never be responsible for a collision and become your friend. Now, in the process of doing this, one of our first meetings with everyone involved in the project was a meeting that we entitled "What Could Go Wrong?" And so we had this massive brainstorming session about all the different things, that all the different scenarios in which these technologies could not do what they were intended to do. And this actually leads us to interesting technical and policy questions about how to think about the use and the deployment of technology. So on the technical side, it is possible to put some guardrails with technology. But when we deploy the technology, that's insufficient.
Right.
We really need policymakers and business leaders to really understand the capabilities and figure out what are safe and positive uses of the technology that we deploy.
Mm-hmm. Love to hear either of you on this too.
Yeah, I don't know what the right guardrails are, but I think the first step in finding them is for people to be asking the right questions.
Yeah.
So my answer to your previous question about what are the, you know, what's the biggest misconception I guess people have about robots would have been, I think, very similar to Daniela's. The quotation I'm going to mangle from Pedro Domingos is about computers more generally. So the issue is that people are worried about the wrong things. Right, and his quotation about computers is like, people are worried that computers are going to get too smart and take over the world. And the problem, the real problem is that they're too stupid and they already have taken over the world. People put too much trust in the wrong things and don't worry about the right things. So people worry about, you know, are robots going to kill us all? Right, and that's, we could talk about why that's not a thing to worry about, but like, I don't think that's a thing to worry about. Whereas, you know, when do I have my self-driving car? People have a tendency to put too much trust in something that's not yet ready for it. And so you get things like the tragedy with the person, you know, trusting their car to not drive them into a truck. And,
right.
You know. So I think having that understanding of where the field is and where we should be thinking about putting guide rails is going to be the first step in putting them in.
Okay. Merritt, I'd love to hear you.
Particularly because I dance with a robot, so I think there is that fear that, are robots going to, like, replace humans? And my thoughts about it right now are, like, looking back in time when, you know, we had the painters and then the camera came out, and I think every painter was like, oh my God, my job's over. Like, no one's ever gonna want a painting ever again. Like, this is completely over. And what turned out to be the case is that actually the camera became a tool for a different time of the human expression. So I think that, like, I'm working with a robot, but it's not replacing humans. It's just a different tool for my expression. And that I think that many more robotic dances will happen in the future, and you'll be able to see that quality. You'll be like, oh, that's that choreographer or that choreographer. It'll never be, like, for instance, it's not like iPhone Sarah, you know, we don't name the iPhone and say, oh, this is a picture from the iPhone. We say it's the human behind the iPhone who took
it. Like, this picture that
it's
I took, yeah.
It's
yeah,
the human. Yeah. It's not the actual, we don't have a name or say, oh, that you know, photo is from the machine that's named. And in the same way, I don't think it's gonna be like, oh, you know, we're not gonna have robots that are particularly, they'll assist in choreographing, but it's definitely, I think, going to be the humans that bring on that nuance, and not just in the artistic world, but also in real world.
Hmm. Okay, so here's another one. What are our current limitations in AI and robotics? And what may we do to break down those limitations? You want to start?
Pointing me?
Yeah.
Sure. So I think, again, the problem that I guess I have with machine learning is that it's super effective as an engineering tool, and we don't understand it, right? Like, if we want a computer to do a thing,
yeah,
right, we put a lot of computational power on it, we get something that seems to work really well, but we don't know how it's doing it. We don't know under what circumstances it will do it correctly, and what might make it suddenly do something very different. So it can be very useful as a tool, but I think, you know, certainly if we're interested in the you know, the scientific side of things, understanding what the thing is doing is difficult. And from the safety side of things, understanding when it's going to be reliable is critical. Uh-huh. And so the two areas that I think people are working on, but that aren't the majority of work in AI, in machine learning, I should say, are explainable AI. How do you create systems where they can tell a person what they're doing and why, and then you can understand the process that leads to the outcome. And also, there's some work in trying to understand what's actually going on in a deep neural network that is so opaque to us. But you know, if we could understand that better, we could have a better confidence that
right,
it's doing what we want.
Okay.
Can I
chime
in?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Yeah, so I think it's important to realize that the greatest successes we read about with machine learning and AI are due to a technique called deep neural networks. And this idea was invented decades ago. It's now enhanced by data and computation, and we see these extraordinary results. So a first challenge is to come up with new ideas, because without new ideas, we will be limited to the scope of the current tools. And as far as the challenges with the current tools, I want to echo what Justin said about the fact that they are mostly black boxes. This is because we end up creating huge models that have lots and lots of artificial neurons in them, and that need huge amounts of data for training and for in order for them to do good inference, because the performance of these algorithms is only as good as the data
right,
used to train them. If the data is bad, the performance will be bad. If the data is biased, the performance will be biased. And so this is an additional limitation. It also, these models tend to take huge amounts of energy to train. Training a medium-sized language model releases 626,000 pounds of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is equivalent to the lifetime emissions of five cars. So the size of the models is a challenge. The research community is tackling these ideas. So we're trying, we are working on techniques to bring new ideas. We're working on techniques to make the models more explainable. We're making progress in compressing and creating compact, much more energy efficient models. But these are all challenges. And then there are a couple more. The tools are not very robust. Mm-hmm. It's kind of easy to trick a neural network who looks at the picture of a pig and is convinced that the pig is in fact a pig. If you insert a few, if you change a few bits in the picture, you end up with a prediction of an airliner or a flying pig. So this kind of robustness is a challenge, and especially when we have safety critical applications, right. We really need robustness. And the last one I want to flag is what we call causality. It's this idea that we really want machine learning to capture the relationship between cause and effect. And with each of these properties that we want to improve upon, we actually have technical progress, but we're not quite where we would like to be.
Interesting. Okay. Merritt, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, the exciting thing, I think, with limitations is also it means like there's so much opportunity and so many questions of like, you know, what are the stereotypes of robots right now? They're like steel, hard, cold. And so like the opposite is like, ooh, how can we make them more flowy, emotional, fluid, fuzzy, all of that stuff. And the questions of how, at one, if we're going to have them in the home, how do you make it safe? Like everything that's been discussed on that side. But there's, there are lots of avenues and lots of opportunities for research to improve these, the robots in AI.
Yeah. Well, we have actually one more video, a little clip that I'd like to play. This is one that you might have seen before because it's a pretty famous example from C-Sail. It's the C-Sail Cheetah robot. The mini robot, right? There's the earlier one was the bigger one, right?
Correct. So it's such an exciting project, such an extraordinary project. And so first of all, let me say that this project is an example of how we need to stretch our minds and expand what we see as robots. Because traditional robots, like the industrial manipulators, or the humanoid robots are really inspired by the human form. Mm-hmm. And they're made out of rigid materials. And in fact, on the factory floor, those robots have to be isolated from people because they're too dangerous to be around. And your robots are not too close to you either, right? In your dances. So we have an opportunity to make more adaptive robots, to make robots that are made out of different materials, and to make robots that are inspired by different aspects of the natural world and of the built environment. So the cheetah is inspired by the natural world. It's such an exciting robot. It really allows us to not only engineer this extraordinary system that does a different range of tasks than what an industrial manipulator can do. But it also, a system like this also gives us an opportunity to learn about the natural world, to learn about the brains of natural systems. And so I'm really excited about this avenue of research in robotics. With this particular project, what's really extraordinary is the advancement of a new class of approaches to building good brains for robots. And these approaches are called sim-to-real approaches, meaning that a lot of the training of the robot is done in simulation. So you have a very accurate model of the robot and of the task and the environment, and then you try hundreds and thousands and even millions of simulations, because in simulation everything is so fast.
Yeah.
And you can collect so much experience and so much feedback on how the robot, how the action of the robot has a consequence on the robot body and on the environment. And so the cheetah was trained in simulation to achieve this really extraordinary behavior, where it can now be so adaptive, it can change how it responds based on feedback it receives from the kind of contact it makes with the environment, or from the kind of obstacles that it sees. And this is really critical when we talk about using machine learning for training, because we talked about the importance of data and how the data really defines the performance of the system. Well, the data has to contain critical corner cases. It has to contain the kinds of events that are really challenging for the robot and might be difficult to generate in the physical world. So I will say, in a different context, if you want to train a robot car to drive, you need examples of crashes and of chaotic driving, and those examples are really difficult to get in the physical setting.
But you could do it in simulation
to prepare the vehicle for these challenging environments.
Well, there's something that you said that I wanted to actually turn to Justin about, because at the Museum of Science, there's a little permanent exhibit where there's actually an older version of the cheetah there. There's like a model of it. It's really cool. But also, like 10 feet away from it, there's a little display about robotic bees. And I don't remember whose group is working on it, but it got me thinking. You talked about getting examples from nature, because the thing that fascinates me about sort of examples inspired from the insect world is, like, it's a completely different model of decision making and thinking than we are familiar with as humans, right? Like centralized nervous system type of decision making versus like hive or swarm based decision making, completely just wildly exotic to me. And so, like, is that part of what is so delightfully challenging about using termites as inspiration for the work?
Yeah, I think the most interesting thing to me about this is the connection between what the individuals are doing and what the hive is doing.
Yeah.
But it's also, it's sort of where you put your perspective, right? Because an individual bee, you know, is in this analogy like an individual human. The hive does something interesting. Human society does something interesting that no single person, right, has sort of set out to create. And so that's a much more complicated system. But you know, understanding those connections is a much larger research challenge.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. I suppose human society can be looked at similarly, but that's my plug for insects there. We've got another question here. Okay, so this is another really thoughtful one. How do security and privacy play into your research? Industrial robots on a manufacturing line are one thing, but what about robots in public and private spaces?
So it's a big question, right? I mean, we really we live in a world where anybody can learn everything about us. So asking the question how we maintain privacy is super important. And here we can offer some technological advancements that explicitly target privacy. We are developing in particular two lines. One is in differential privacy, and so differential privacy is refers to a body of algorithms that ensure that people can provide their data for the greater good, but then no individual data is actually individualized. It's actually what's the word I'm looking for? It's localizable. Yeah. So that's one direction. Another direction is homomorphic encryption, where in homomorphic encryption we can do computations on encrypted data, and so then you can hold on to your data. You can again give it for computation for the greater good, but without revealing anything private about yourself. And so some of these technological solutions are getting us part of the way to privacy, but we need much more. And so we need policy, we need guardrails, and we need the kinds of solutions that require that technologists, policy makers, and business leaders come together and sit at the same table to ensure that the right guardrails get defined and put in place.
Yeah. So on that note about, again, guardrails being a theme sort of more broadly, societally, we've got one last question here from the audience. For high-income people, the robot is, or robotics is, an opportunity, but for low-income people, it will replace their jobs. So how do we reach a balance for low-income people with fewer skills?
Well, let's see. Surprisingly, I would say that it's easier to send a robot to Mars than it is to get that robot to clear your dining table after dinner. So it turns out that there are a lot of tasks, primarily around manipulation, that our machines are really hard-pressed to do well on. So I don't think we're anywhere near having all those lower income jobs go away. But having said that, I also think that it's important to anticipate what might happen in 3 years, in 5 years, and put in place programs, educational programs, skilling and reskilling programs that enable people to get access to different jobs. We had a project with a group of miners in Kentucky, where some of the educational tools from CSAIL were used to help the coal miners become data miners. And that was an example of a positive way in which we can tackle some of the jobs that that seem like they might be offloaded to machines. And then some jobs really ought to be done by machines. For instance, if you think about how difficult it is to do recycling sorting.
Yes.
Right. So every week we put out our recycling that goes to massive sorting areas, and then people have to separate your plastics from your papers and from your glass. So why not have robots that could do that with people essentially supervising and controlling the robots? The jobs would not go away, but they would turn from actual manipulation jobs into supervisory jobs. And I think this is actually a theme with technology. As we introduce technologies, new jobs appear that we cannot really anticipate. If we think about the year 2007, so in 2007, we had three important technological advancements: social media, cloud computing, and the iPhone, the smartphones. Mm. Before 2007, we were not imagining app developers, social media manager, right? I mean, we did not imagine a lot of the jobs that were created by these technologies that, in fact, are now employing people at various levels and interests.
I'm just going to just step in here for a second, because I again, the examples are potent that you gave and numerous. I know we have to wrap up, but I want to do one little follow-up, particularly with you, Merritt. I will say that the question is asking about how to essentially protect lower income people who don't necessarily have the skills that can be quickly translated, right, from the world we live in now to the world we might live in 5 years from now. That's why actually your miners example was really interesting. I'd love to know more maybe at another time, because transitions aren't universally beneficial for everyone. That's true, and especially any industrial revolution or kind of or technological revolution is not entirely a perfect thing. But what I wanted to ask you, Merritt, is because of your work really putting together AI and technology with something that will remain uniquely human, right? Expression and creativity. I've been talking to a lot of people who are saying, well, this may be an opportunity for us as a society to really refocus on the things, and including in creating new kinds of jobs that are uniquely the capacity of human beings. Again, we're working on a healthcare series right now, so we're talking to a lot of people who are like, well, the machines should actually be filling out electronic records and doing the diagnosis of ophthalmological illnesses, because what the machines can't do is provide the care, right? So I'm wondering what you think about that as both an artist, a performer, and a scientist as well. Could this be a potential, if we do it right, to almost have a greater flourishing of the things that make us uniquely human?
Definitely, because there's so much, I think, rote stuff that are now incorporated into jobs that aren't necessary. Like the medical one is such a good example, right? Like, I think it would be beneficial to all of society if the doctors were able to sleep a little bit more and the robot was able to fill out that stuff, right? Like, and also in the artistic side, like, well, I think we could come up with more creative ways, like, to really become an expert in a specific field, like ballet. I mean, many of the dancers are trained at age 6 and don't go to high school and 8 hours a day for their entire lives. And a flamenco dancer has a totally different regimen and expertise in that field. But I think people would love to express movement in a way that kind of fuses the two together, but to be an expert in both is very difficult.
Right.
And so I think with AI and like that would be beneficial. And then with robotics, it's just an interesting tool to kind of, I think it just enhance, I really find it as a tool to enhance human creativity.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank all three of you for sharing your work and your passions and your candid thoughts about what also we as society need to do to make the best of the research that you're all doing. So thank you so much for joining us today on this day of AI. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was amazing. We're more hopeful now, right? I'm more hopeful. Thank you. That was just wonderful. And be sure to tune in to WBUR for the new series On Point, Meghna leading the charge, Smarter Health, Artificial Intelligence, and the Future of American Healthcare. That begins May 27th. Mark your calendars. And join us on Monday for the next event in our phenomenal women's series, Women in Biotech. For more on that free virtual conversation, head to wbur.org/events. And thank you. Happy Day of AI.
Thank you. Thank you so much.